Und ich glaube, sie werden gleich noch wacher, denn es ist ein wirklich fantastischer Film. And now I'm going to switch to English because we have a star guest here tonight. And we're very happy that he came all the way to Zurich. He is a very famous and acclaimed movie director. He loves movies. He's very passionate about it. You can see that in all his works. He said earlier that this is his 16th feature film that you're going to see tonight. And we're going to talk a little bit about it. So please welcome the great Atom Egoyan. I move to the back of the room. They're back. It's, don't jump. Exciting. Atom, I just said it earlier. This is a very special movie because it's based on a real story. It's based on the infamous Memphis 3. The horrifying story. I don't know if people know about it, but what attracted you to put that on the big screen?
What attracted me is that it's in some ways it's the ultimate murder mystery. I won't go into details if you don't know about it, because in fact the film probably will work for you in a very different way if you know nothing about the story. But what happened in this community in West Memphis 20 years ago is really extraordinary. And it bears retelling, I think. It's almost mythological in terms of so many issues, but it was very compelling and deeply mysterious. Deeply mysterious, not only in terms of the event itself, but what happened afterwards and what is still happening in terms of the consequences of it. So I don't mean to sound, I just don't want to give it away if you don't know. Actually, I'm curious, how many people here have never heard of the West Memphis 3? See, that's great. So most of you don't know about it. That's fantastic. That's even better. So that's you know, it's funny because we showed it in Toronto, and everyone in America knows the story. But and we showed it last night in San Sebastian, and it's a very different response of people. So I'm excited to see how it goes over.
You know, the story of a movie based on a real story, was it important for you to get the blessing of people involved surrounding what happened back in Memphis? Or did you say, I'm going to retell what happened in the most perfect way that I could?
Well, I don't think there's any perfect way of telling the story, because it's so complex, there's so many different angles. You know, the thing is that everything you're going to hear in the courtrooms, everything you're going to hear in terms of the police interrogations, it's all verbatim, it's all word for word, it's all from transcript, really. So you can't change that in a way. And that was the challenge we had, was to stick to the actual, the words. But it's the, and the lives, of course, that were impacted. I really don't want to talk about the story, because the lives were so impacted by the consequences of this. Some of these lives are public, and others, of course, you know, you needed to get the life story. So that's something that the film needed to do, was to get the approval of some of the people, but not others.
I mean, what was the real response, though? I mean, what did they say?
Well, at the premiere, we had Jason Baldwin, one of the West Memphis Three, and he's represented in the film. You'll see him. He was a teenager 20 years ago, and he just was overwhelmed by it. He loved it. And he's been really supportive of the project from the beginning, and I think the strangest day was when we were filming one of his big scenes where I had an actor playing him, and he was in that courtroom, and he recalls that moment, of course. But it's unimaginable what happened to these two teenagers as a result of you know, the community.
I don't give it away. No, you're not going to give it away. You're just going to talk sort of about the story a little bit more. Within the system probably of making a movie, there's a lot of pressure coming from all sides, studio, producer. Was it ever an option for you to exaggerate the story? I mean, if we look at something that comes from Hollywood, you know, they try to exaggerate the story but turn it into something that, you know, people leave the movie theater with a good feeling, or, you know, sort of happy ending. Well, did you ever have to change it, or did you restricting stick to what
happens? That's a really, really good question. I think, look, there are elements of horror in this film, and those are both in the story, but also in the treatment, because I think what happened in that forest was really horrible. But in terms of the happy ending, that's a really good question, because I think some of you will feel this at the end, which is that there can't be, because there isn't in real life. You know, this kind of continues in a way. So to put that on artificially was never really an option, because it just didn't occur. So you couldn't construct that. You know, it would be false to the telling of it. So we were very aware of the tone and keeping a certain tone to the piece. And you'll see that one of the interesting things, I think, is that it moves from, you know, a naturalism into kind of a horror, into courtroom drama, and then into something else. And I think what's really extraordinary is, for those of you who know my films, you'll think the language of this might seem more conventional at first, but then it does something actually more radical than I've ever done in any movie. And I think that'll become apparent when you see it, just in terms of how movies are supposed to end. So I think that is unusual, but that's how it does end. And I think it's very brave of the two actors, Reese and Colin, you know, who usually play heroic roles where they change things. And this, you'll see them do something quite different, and it's very, very generous and daring of them to go to this place and to really become part of this ensemble. It's a very large cast, and they really inhabit this world, which is, in the case of Reese, Witherspoon, she was a very clear choice from the beginning, because she's from this part of America, and she really understands the temperament, and she was very concerned that this person be represented in the right way. And you'll see she looks very different. It's not the glamorous Reese Witherspoon, it's very different looking. And she inhabits this completely. And it's one of the more, risky and generous things that she did. So, you know, I'm always blessed with a really, I'm in awe of all of these actors. I think they all took these roles very seriously. You know, in terms of what you were saying, some of them tracked down the characters that they were playing quite obsessively. And, you know, others didn't, but many of them actually found the people that they were portraying and got them to talk. And so every day after we were shooting, we would just hang out and tell these amazing stories of what we'd learned that day. This is a case, after you see the movie, if you go online and look for material, you'll see all these sites, and it just goes on and on and on. Like, it's almost Kafka-esque. It just doesn't end. Like, all the material that's been presented, the investigation. The thing that is at the core of it is this crime that happened in this forest, where there was, you'll see, a very, very violent kind of event, but absolutely no evidence around. No DNA, no blood, no footsteps, no branches were disturbed. It was very, very strange and supernatural. So the question was to create this feeling of a very natural world, very, very, and then intersecting with something that's very heightened. So it had a lot of challenges. It took a lot of time to edit, much longer than my other movies. We were working on the post-production of this for a long time. And I'm excited. It turned out great.